Good to go. Okay. Hey, what's going on, y'all? Pastor Jake here. I'm really excited to have you tuning in and checking out this week's message. Last week, we began a series called Pivot. And the whole point behind that, behind this series is two-part. One, there are times in our lives where things are going to happen, where life is going to change, and we are going to be faced with the need to pivot or to make an adjustment or course correct. And but also that this is not a new thing, that we are not alone in being faced with moments like this, that we see all throughout Scripture, we see all throughout history that people have had to pivot and are continuing to have to pivot. You know, I mean, for instance, this school year has been a major pivot, I know, for many of you, whether it's going from in-person to online at the start here, or going from going to school to doing the homeschool thing. We've all had to pivot in one way or another this year. And so, but what we see as we look throughout Scripture, specifically around this topic of pivoting, are three themes that I want us to spend our time with. And the first is the importance of trusting God, that when we pivot, when we're faced with those changes that we have to make, we have to do it fully trusting in God's presence and promise to be with us each and every step of the way. The second theme that we see is the need to be humble, to have a humble heart, not just to recognize where the changes or the adjustments are being needed to make. That didn't sound right, but anyways, you know what I mean. But to hear from others who God has placed in our life to speak into our lives, to help us see things from a different perspective. We need to be humble to hear from those around us. And then finally, pivoting requires courage. And what we'll see next week is that when we have to pivot, it requires courage. But what we're seeing this morning or this afternoon, whenever you're watching this, and what we'll see again next week is that these all go together, that these aren't individual themes, but that they all work together, that when you trust in God and you're humble and you have courage that is rooted in Jesus, we can pivot in a way that is centered on God's will for our life. And so this morning we're going to talk about the need to be humble. And if you remember from last week's video, I talked about how in high school when I played football, we would get together the morning after a game, and we would watch the film from the game the night before. And we did this not to celebrate or, you know, inflate our egos, you know, based on what we did. We did it as an instruction tool, as a way to look and see what we did well and to be able to build on that, but also to see where there were gaps and how we needed to grow and adjust and make some of those course corrections. And this was not always an easy thing for me personally to do. I loved being able to, being celebrated whenever I made a good play or a big hit or whatever, but I hated being called out for things that I did wrong. I hated seeing those things on the screen in front of me that I did wrong. But what I learned from it is that there was a need for me to be humble, to receive the instruction, to receive the correction from my coaches, not because they wanted to embarrass me, but because they wanted to help me grow. And so when we talk about pivoting, when we talk about making changes and growing, being humble, having humility as a part of our perspective and attitude is an important piece. And here's what I want us to focus on, to center on this morning, is that pivoting requires trust. That when we pivot, whether it's with school or whatever it is, that there has to be a level of trust that we have in God, that He will be with us each step of the way. But we also have to do so humbly. Hearing from those around us, helping us to see those areas and those gaps where we can grow. And so we're going to look at that through a story in 2 Samuel. So if you have a Bible, turn with me to 2 Samuel chapter 12. And we're going to look at David. Many of you know who David is. He's the one with the slingshot and Goliath. He's the one who became king of Israel. He is also the one who is often referred to as a man after God's own heart. Like, King David's a pretty big deal, pretty awesome guy. But there were moments in his life where he was met with instruction and correction and confrontation, where he had to demonstrate an attitude, a spirit of humility, in order to grow, in order to become who God had created him to be, which was to be a man after God's own heart. And so instead of reading the entire chapter, because that would take a really long time, I want to run through and just kind of give us a brief overview of what's happening here in the first half of chapter 12 to kind of help set the stage for what we're going to focus on. And so chapter 12 of 2 Samuel begins with this guy named Nathan going to David, and he begins to tell David the story. And it's a story of these two guys where, one is a good guy and, you know, does everything right. The other is kind of a shady character who is getting away with things. And essentially, you know, it's a story of injustice and unfairness. And as Nathan is telling David this story, David's getting fired up. David's getting frustrated and upset about the fact that this shady character in the story is getting away with things. And so Nathan finishes the story, and David's all fired up at this point. And he's like, I don't get it. It's not fair. Like, it's not right. And Nathan kind of takes a step back and goes, David, you're the shady guy. You're the bad. You represent this bad character. You have made some choices in your life that have been questionable. And what he is saying, he's referring to the affair David had with Bathsheba and getting her pregnant, and then following that, sending her husband to the front line of the battle, and then working it out with the other generals to make sure that he died in order for David to be able to marry her and to not feel like, at this point, David was being kind of shady with some of the things that he had been doing. And so David is hearing Nathan say this. And what we get through this interaction is two things. We see two things. The first is we see a trust between these two guys. We see a trust in Nathan, knowing that he could go to David with this. One, because God had told him and led him to, but he knew that David could receive and would receive what he had to say. But we also see a trust in David, trusting Nathan, knowing that Nathan was speaking on behalf of the Lord, that he knew that Nathan was not just making things up. He trusted that what Nathan was saying was real and was accurate. The second thing we see is we see humility in both Nathan and David. We see a humility in Nathan, knowing that you know, what he had to say was hard. He knew what he had to say David was not going to enjoy, yet he did it because that's what God had called him to. And then we see humility in David to not only hear and receive what Nathan was doing, but in his response to it. Towards the end of this section in chapter 12, we see David just falling on his knees, praying earnestly, asking God for forgiveness, asking for God to intervene and bring restoration where there was brokenness. And so what I want us to focus in on is David's ability to hear what Nathan had to say. This was not easy. Like I said a few minutes ago, I hated when what I did wrong was pointed out, because I did not want to be embarrassed or called out in front of my teammates. Yet it was an important part of my growth, both as a football player and even as I've grown and learned and spent time in ministry. Is it's an important piece to growth as a person, to be able to hear some of those things that to hear about those gaps in our lives. And the second piece to that is that David doesn't just stay put in that hearing it piece. He doesn't stay put in that woe is me, that pity party, kind of like, oh man, I really suck kind of an attitude. David hears it and he responds through his actions, that immediately he begins to act differently, to seek God, to look to God for help in growing and moving. And so as we talk about pivoting, I think it's important for us to understand that even though it is necessary, it's not always going to be easy, and it's not always going to feel great to have to pivot. But we can, and it's important to do so, knowing that, one, we can trust in God, but two, we can also do so with a heart of humility, centered on that trust that we have that God will be with us each and every step of the way. And so as we wrap up, I want to just encourage us, to challenge us, to remember that life is going to throw some challenges, some obstacles our way, and we're going to be forced to pivot. But when we are forced to pivot, y'all, remember that we can do it with God right beside us, promising to be with us. We can trust that He will be with us, and that it will require a heart of humility to not only be led by the Lord, but to allow others to speak into, to provide guidance and a different perspective as we seek to follow the will that God has set for our lives. Let me pray for us. Lord, I thank You for Your word, and I thank You for the opportunity that we have to spend time reading it, to take the examples, the stories that we see in it, and to learn from them. I pray, Lord, that as we are faced each and every day with moments and the realization of the need to pivot, to make adjustments in our lives, that, Lord, we would do so fully trusting in You and Your presence each step of the way, but that we would also do so with an attitude and a heart of humility, Lord, that we would follow David's example, that we wouldn't just hear and see where the changes are needed to be made, but that we would act on it, that we would respond accordingly. I pray for each person who is watching, listening to this message, that, Lord, You would bless them, that they would experience Your presence today in any way possible. And that You would continue to lead them each and every day going forward. And so, Lord, we love You, and we pray all these things in Your name. Amen. Have a good week, y'all. We'll see you next week.